Beautiful Monday morning to you, viewers out there. Good to welcome you to your One Stop Breakfast program on MCL TV. Good morning, Abia. Ojabwa is my name. It's the 16th day of the month of April 2018. We thank God for another day He has given to us and another working week, beginning of the working week of this very week. And I want to urge you to be at your best. Every Monday morning, I challenge people to be at their best. Reason is simple. After the weekend rest, you need to have, you would have gotten all that you need to push, you know, higher ground and then break more frontiers. All right, this morning, we're going to do it the way we do it every morning. Starting with the words on Marble, you know, this program comes to inform, entertain, and educate you. And when it comes to educating the people, it begins with the words on Marble, where we learn solid things every morning. And today, this is what it has to tell us. No legacy is so rich as honesty, William Shakespeare. No legacy is so rich as honesty. No matter who you are, what you do, how you do it, honesty should be your watchword. Everywhere you are, people should know you as a man of honesty. You should be able to be very transparent at all times, okay? Be you a leader in the government circle, in the church, in any organization, up to any establishment, you really need to show transparency. You need to be very honest in everything you do. Only by so doing would men reckon with you, and try at all times to you know, let people know the kind of person you are. Once you're known and seen to be a man of honesty, a man that moves at all times, believing that the truth, you know, should prevail, people will want to deal with you. That's a very great lesson today. You also have the right to start being an honest person today. Perhaps from yesterday going down, you were already that honest. You had things today that were not in line with a man that should be reckoned with when it comes to honesty. You can still change today. There's always room for improvement. There's always room for change. They can begin today, and then you will also be reckoned with tomorrow. All right, that is it on the how we start this very morning. Let's now go to the news. Today we're going to be starting with this very news. All right, drainage channels are constructed to ease the flow of water. Though some drainages have been turned into dumping places for waste materials, which are sold to the eyes and create stagnant water that create breeding grounds for bacteria and mosquitoes. MCL News visited some areas where debris is being scooped from the drainages. Elizabeth Carlo has the story.
A visit to Ukebu by Ikotekpene Road at Obohi shows that debris were being evacuated by the men of Abia State Environmental Protection Agency, ASEPA, while the scooping of other gutters was ongoing. Speaking to our correspondent on the steps taken to ensure that drainages are kept clean, the Deputy General Manager of Abia State Environmental Protection Agency, Roland Nwakama, acknowledges that it is the responsibility of the agency to evacuate debris that are dumped by the roadside. He said the agency has always discharged its duties.
You can observe what we are doing. It's part of the check we want to measure, we want to use to make sure that we'll combat flooding. That's why we decided to deseed the gutter within Ukotapene Road. Most of the roads have been deseeded. And what we are doing is the question of what the debris will come from the gutter to avoid flood. It's going on all the roads within this zone. What is important to me is to open up the gutter. I promise you, we'll remove all the waste we have seen.
Residents who spoke to our correspondent said they are playing their part by scooping the gutters before the rain sets in fully. They, however, call on ASEPA to assist them by coming on time to evacuate the debris scooped from the gutters.
Days ago, the government ordered the people living around to use their manpower to clean up the drainage while they assist them. 2 days ago, the people used their strength to clean up the drainage while the government assists in removing it.
Ilan and I got us again on a na-eju ebe ahụ wụ pure water, empty sachet of pure water. Anyị kwesịrị anyị ṅụọ ya, anyị nwere ebe anyị ga na-atụpụ ya so that o nwere ihe ọzọ a ga-eji ya mee ga-abara obodo uru ewere ya mee. Anyị ga na ya gwọkwa gọta anyị mgbe kwesịrị ka anyị gwọọ ya so that mmiri baa na gọta ka o nwee bụ na-achọghị.
We actually advise our people, the Abia citizens or Aba citizens, to try as much as possible to not to be putting waste products inside the drainages. They should convert the habit of keeping the drainage system neat so that at the end of the day, when the rain comes, the gutters or the drainage system can be able to carry the rain conveniently.
It is heartwarming to know that ASEPA are diligently carrying out their duties just as the residents equally know their responsibilities. If all hands are put on deck, Aba residents will not be afraid of the rainy season. Elizabeth Kalu, MCL News.
President Muhammadu Buhari has said that it will be impossible for his administration to identify and recover looted funds of the country. He also said that his administration has not done badly when compared to what it met on ground when he took over in 2015. The president said the damage done to the Nigeria's economy in the years of plunder was massive and that government was doing its best to recover some of the loot, but noted that it was impossible to identify and recover all. The president stated this in London Sunday while receiving the Buhari Diaspora Support Organization led by Mr. Charles F. Sylvester. He noted that Nigeria was gifted with tremendous human and natural resources, but regretted that failure of some of the leadership we had in the past led to our not being able to capitalize on resources to improve the lot of the people. He commended the Buhari Diaspora Support Organization for deciding to identify with the country when you could have stayed here and be comfortable. The coordinator of the organization, Mr. Sylvester, said the group was happy with the achievements of the Buhari administration so far. Director General of the National Agency for the Prohibition of Trafficking in Persons, Ms. Julia Oka Danley, has bemoaned the mass recruitment of Nigerians to Saudi Arabia and other Middle East countries. This was even as the NEPTIP Director General said the agency has convicted a total number of 341 persons since inception. Speaking during a familiarization tour of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Oka Danley, who was received by the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Geoffrey Onyema, said the NEPTIP delegation was at the ministry to fine-tune ways of working with the ministry more from inside. She said there was need for greater collaboration between NEPTIP and the Minister of Foreign Affairs and the embassies. Oka Danley recalled a distress call she received from a Nigerian victim in Saudi Arabia who ran to the Nigerian embassy and did not receive the necessary assistance. She said the same situation exists in some other Nigerian embassies, saying that virtually all the embassies react the same way. She lamented mass recruitment to Saudi Arabia, Oman, Dubai, Egypt, and so on by agents under the aegis of providing employment as in households and nurses to Saudi Arabian nationals. She decried the level of sexual exploitation and organ harvesting of recruited Nigerians in the Middle Eastern countries. So we fear that most of these people that are really accounted for may never return, that are really unaccounted for, sorry, may never return alive, and there is need, sir, to do something very seriously about this trend, Oka Danley said. The NEPTIP Director General further raised the alarm over cases of recruitment of very young boy and girl by so-called sports agents, taking them to various countries, saying, of course, their organs are being harvested. Responding, Onyema said the analysis of the situation brought out very clearly how grave the situation is. Onyema also said one area that is of a challenge is the division between the regular migrants and trafficked persons. He added that another area that needed to be looked into clearly is the labor contracts and arrangements. In the face of prevalent kidney diseases in the country, there is the need for government and good-spirited individuals to help sufferers of the ailment in the areas of medical subsidy and kidney donations. a kidney disease expert, Dr. Chimezie Okwuonu, made the call during an exclusive chat with MCL News. Emmanuel Mazwe has the report.
It is no longer news that Nigeria has a frightening number of people suffering different stages of kidney disease. For instance, on the 4th of March this year, The Guardian quoted statistics released by the Nigerian Association of Nephrology as saying that 25 million Nigerians suffer kidney failure. The statistics went ahead to suggest that 18,000 of the sufferers need dialysis every year, with only 160 nephrologists to care for the patients per 1 million population. Not only that, about 400,000 naira is needed for dialysis monthly, costing about 30,000 naira per session. With this worrisome development and high cost of treatment, an Omaha-based nephrologist, Dr. Chimezie Okwuonu, says government needs to include kidney transplant and dialysis in this universal health policy.
The cost of kidney transplantation is high and only few individuals can afford it. And this is where government can come in to bring in these services to rich people and to subsidize, to assist patients that are going for kidney transplantation so as to make the burden lighter. And then to the people that are being helped, they should not always be looking at India, Dubai, and all these places for their transplantation. Transplantation is in Nigeria now. And even in Abia State, in the Federal Medical Center, Umuahia, kidney transplantation has commenced. Four has been done successfully, and the cost is one of the cheapest all over the world.
He identified people's unwillingness to donate kidneys to patients as one of the challenges in the fight against kidney diseases, and therefore called for help.
God has given us two kidneys. The essence is that for us to help people that, to give, be able to donate one kidney to people that have kidney failure. What you really need to be alive is just one kidney. So by the time one kidney fails, or by the time the two kidneys fail, and you have an opportunity as a person to donate one to another person, if we can overcome that barrier, then we'll be talking about the cost of kidney transplantation.
According to the kidney disease expert, some of the manifestations of the disease include loss of appetite, hiccups, vomiting, general body weakness, swollen face and legs, reduced quantity of urine, among others. He also identified high blood pressure, skin bleaching, diabetes, obesity, alcoholism, and smoking are some of the major causes of kidney diseases. People are therefore called to apply caution in their lifestyles and imbibe the culture of routine medical assessments. Emmanuel Mazwe, MCL News.
Nigerian President Muhammadu Buhari will be the guest of U.S. President Donald Trump on 30th April in Washington, the White House announced on Sunday. According to the statements, Trump will discuss issues such as promoting economic growth and fighting terrorism with Buhari. The relationship of the United States with Nigeria is deep and strong, and Nigeria's economic growth, security, and leadership in Africa will advance our mutual prosperity, the statement said. Nigeria has been combating the terrorist organization Boko Haram since 2009. The State Department under Trump approved the sale of 12 high technology attack planes and equipment worth $600 million to Nigeria last year after the Obama administration halted the sale because of accusations that Nigeria's Air Force was bombing civilians. The scheduled meeting will be the second between the two leaders. Last year, September, the two leaders met on the sidelines of the United Nations General Assembly. During a luncheon Trump held for a select group of African leaders, President Buhari, who came to power in 2015, announced last week, Monday, that he plans to seek re-election in 2019. The Nigerian leader, who left Abuja for the UK on Monday, will attend the Commonwealth Heads of Government Summit, which is in London on 18th April and ends on 28th April.
All right, that is the size of the news this morning. We'll go for a break. When we return, we'll take a look at the papers. Still stay with us.
Podcast Show on TV. Show on TV.
I urge you to set aside our differences so that together we can join hands and build the Abia of our dreams. Remember that my word is my bond.
Show on TV.
Do not deface Abia State with posters. Do not defecate on our streets. Do not litter Abia State.
my brothers, I say, waiting man will do for this world where people not go talk. If you chop,
do not urinate in public places.
You no chop, they go talk. Waiting make you do for this world. I say, make we do the things where we carry for heart. Now so world wonder. Have you not been so?
Keep Abia State clean. This message is brought to you by MCL TV.
Show on TV.
It's time for us to take a look at the papers, starting with the Daily Sun, as usual. Abga Woos Ihedioha declares PDP dead in Imo. Stories on page 12. Abga Woos Ihedioha declares PDP dead in Imo. Also, the man on how to end marginalization says Imo must produce president in 2023. Also, find this story on page 12. And the picture element. Under this very story headline is Governor Rogers Okorocha of Imo State Medo with the Minister of State for Niger Delta, Professor Claudius Omeloye Daramola, fifth left. Honorable Nana Igbokwe of the House of Representatives and other senior government functionaries when the minister visited at the government house for Owerri. Buhari blames past leaders for nation's woes, meets Tinubu in London. Aisha makes return, declares support for president. That story is on page 6 and 11. Of course, the wife of the president has said sometime last year that should the president decides to run again, she wouldn't give her support, but she has now made a U-turn. Imo Guba 2019 election easier to win, Okorocha boast. That's on page 12. Imo Guba 2019 election easier to win. 17 Chibok girl, school girls' parents dead. 17 Chibok school girls' parents dead. BOG, remaining girls, Lee, Sherry Bush rescue, a must. Saraki, you find this story on page 6. Well, there's so much to talk about concerning the Chibok girls. It's their fourth anniversary. This is exactly 4 years ago these kids were kidnapped. And now, what are we still discussing? Oh, well, during the discussion segment, we're going to talk more on the Chibok girls. Only God will determine my successor, Dixon. Only God will determine my successor. And you find the story on page 38. Going to the back page of the paper, we meet Kashmir Igbokwe, who will jail our ex-presidents. That's on page 47, who will jail our ex-presidents. And on Sports Gold Coast 2018, Team Nigeria finishes ninth position. Find it on page 45. All right, going down, we meet Ojo Zokalo,
Adeniyi's misguided attack. Adeniyi's misguided attack. And here you have the face of Adeniyi. All right, now we take a bit of this very article. It says, as someone who is versed in politics, as Segun claimed, I expect him to use his page to educate Nigerians more on the tenets of democracy and their rights, and not to spread fear about the political profile of Dr. Kalu or his campaigns for Buhari. Okay, if you go to that to the back page of the Daily Sun, you'll be able to read up more on this very story. Adeniyi's misguided attack is coming from Ojozo. All right, leaving the Daily Sun, the next paper is The Nation. APC Gates Convention Committee, Jigawa governor is chair. Our story is on page 3. Monarch rejects Biafra agitation. Find the story on page 11 as NNDC to generate 7,000 megawatts for Niger Delta. That's on page 38. And Man City crown EPL champions. Find it on page 47. And going down, we have the picture elements here. That up from left, Zenith Bank PLC chairman Jim Ovie, group managing director and chief executive officer Peter Amambo, and deputy managing director Adeora Umoji at the firm's 27th annual general meeting held in Abuja at the weekend. And the other one is from left, Coronation Merchant Bank managing director and chief executive officer Abubakar Jumo, chairman Babatunde Falawoye, and company secretary legal advisor Cornelia Utuk at the company's third annual general meeting held in Lagos, also at the weekend. On the inside, U.S. to review council operations in Nigeria. That's on page 7. My successor by Dixie. You find on page 38. Okay, the major headline is on pro Buhari group to Saraki. Why our ban cannot stand. Why our ban cannot stand. Senators to stick with Omoagege, fear over Adamu's likely suspension. Going down, we meet Luther did not cover tracks well, says President. Luther did not cover tracks well, says the President. Nigeria has received $14.2 billion from World Bank Group. Buhari and Tinubu meet in London. Right, the picture element is also President Buhari, right, and Asiwaju Tinubu in London yesterday. JAMB concludes UTME in eight countries. Page 6, as Enugu among states paying well. Find it on page 11. All right, we'll go to the back page of the paper this month as The Nation. And we'll meet today in The Nation. He has attracted powerful endorsement through the power of his performance. As the 2019 elections approaches, it is foreseeable that Ambode will enjoy more endorsements. Femi Macaulay. All right, we'll meet Sam Omoseye in touch. Mistaken identity. And here you have the face of Odigie Oyegun. Okay, Adebanjo, not my progressive. I have the face of Chief Adebanjo here. All right, we meet Hardballs, the professor of quaint desire. And by the left there, you have reports. Says police recover 83 assorted illegal arms in Bauchi. That is the news. And reports said only 83. I'm gonna shine your eyes. I think we really need it. As a very way of saying things, the funny way, even when it's the truth. Okay, dropping The Nation, The New Telegraph is the next paper with us as the last, but definitely not the least. Total exploration. Management and workers feel deepens. Nupeng awaits Pengasin's call for solidarity. Nigerian Airlines spent over 120 billion naira on aviation fuel. That's on page 6. Now on page 7, you meet this mother. I was tortured to implicate Senator Sani, civilian JTF.
I was touched out to implicate Senator Sani. Can you see that? All right, go to page 10. You find rescue of Chibok girls. Lee Sharibu, a must. I mean, from Saraki. You can't foist your son-in-law on us. Senator Tiles Okorocha. That's on page 33. And on insecurity, immigration arrest 67 irregular migrants. The story is on page 10. And the major headline is on 2019. We have not decided on Buhari, says ACF. That's on page 4 and 10. IBB to Nigerians, queue behind SDP. President Miss Tinubu in London says we have done well. Support groups kickstart activities. All right, go to page 4 and 10 to read up these stories. And then the picture element here is that of, from left to right, Deputy Managing Director Zenith Bank PLC, Ebenezer Onyango, Group Managing Director and Chief Executive Officer Peter Amambo, and Chairman Jim Ovia at the bank's 27th Annual General Meeting, AGM in Abuja, at the weekend. Momo to federal government named past president on Luther's list. AGF blackmail won't stop debt recovery. Says you can't intimidate us, Minister tells PDP chiefs. The story is on page 5. Sitting all day shrinks brain, raises smartest risk. That's on page 35. All right, we'll go to the back page of the paper. That's the New Telegraph, and first we'll meet on marbles. Don't be afraid of your fears. They are not there to scare you. They are there to let you know that something is worth it. Joy Bauce. All right, Joy Bauce. Don't be afraid of your fears. They are not there to scare you. They are there to let you know that something is worth it. All right, move over to page 37, and you meet this first story. Kwadiri happy with gold in silver. Kwadiri happy with gold in silver. Talking about the Commonwealth Games that have just ended. Growing Nigeria's economy, improving governance. Atiku Abubakar, get columnist today. Growing Nigeria's economy, improving governance. Atiku Abubakar, now you also have the face of the president. Yeah, he says, if we restructure our federation, make compromises, and govern better, we will have a greater chance of transforming our diversity into a national asset. That is just a bit of this very article. Hope you read it up yourself when you pick a copy of the New Telegraph. And then High Chief also says, Mona killed at burial ceremony. Mona killed at burial ceremony. That's the news. Ah, that's double wahala. Okay, you know what we'll do? Just a tip of the iceberg. I expect you to visit your vendor, send for any of the national dailies, even as you continue to watch the program, and then read up the stories. Yourself so much to read up. So I encourage you to pick any of the papers we've given to you here, and many more too that we couldn't bring your way as well. All right, we'll go for a break. When we come back, it will be time for our discussion segment, and we're going to be centering on the 4th anniversary of the Chibok Girls. How have we fared? The way forward? Well, I'm sure you would like to be part of this, even as we're going into 2019 elections. All right, we'll see you shortly. We'll be right back.
Show on TV.
All of my life I've been searching For inquiries and booking, contact Address Hotel and Suites at number 18 Opobo Road, Obo Hill, Aba. Telephone 081-000-00895 or 081-000-00896. Adrex, the pride of hospitality and tourism.
Have you heard of Cresco World and Heaven Options Limited? Cresco is a home of the red image right here in Aba. Why go to Lagos or Port Harcourt for your direct image jobs? Come to Cresco World and Heaven Options located at number 145 Azikiwe Road, Aba, for perfect cover page, journals, magazines, brochures, and flyers. We also offer printing services in digital flex and billboard, window graphics, posters, stickers, heat transfers, ID cards, complimentary cards, monogram, and car branding. Heaven Options offer you entertainment services like event management, ambulance services with well-dignified undertakers. We can also boast of 3 months ordinary program in computer training, 6 months certificate in computer training, and 1 year advanced certificate in computer training. Why not visit Cresco and experience that quality jobs? For inquiries, call 080-33-22-6115-070-40-24-7196-070-84-69-8165.
Do not deface Abia State with posters. Do not defecate on our streets. Do not litter Abia State.
My brothers, I say, what did man go do for this world where people not go talk? If you chop,
do not urinate in public places.
You no chop, then go talk. What did man go do for this world? I say, make we go do the things where we carry for hands. Now so world wonder. I be not been so.
Keep Abia State clean. This message is brought to you by MCL TV.
Show on TV.
Hvis nu jeg siger, at jeg er i gang med at lave en film nu. Mm. Det er min film. Jeg er i gang med at lave en film. Mm. Jeg vil spørge jer, om I vil være med til, om jeg må filme jer og lave en film om os som familie.
Hvad slags film skulle det være? Altså, er det sådan en kort film eller en lang, en lang film? Eller, altså...
Det ved jeg ikke. Det må man se, hvor godt materialet er.
Og hvad skulle den bruges til? Andet end til din egen fornøjelse?
Som et første oplæg til en mulig film.
Hvad siger du til det, Agne? Vil du have noget imod at slukke kameraet nu, Birte?
Ja, det vil jeg have meget imod.
Må du så ikke bare gøre det, selvom du har meget imod? Du kan jo se, at det her rammer far.
Ja. Det rammer sgu også mig. Ja.
Thank you. Are they?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Bye.
Good afternoon.
Hey.
How are you doing?
Yeah.
Good to see you again.
Yeah. When did you come?
Excuse me?
Yeah.
When I came?
Yeah.
Yesterday.
Yeah. How's mama and sister from there?
Everybody's fine.
It has been long.
5 years.
Yeah.
5 years now. Nice shoes.
Is it the shoes?
Just the shoes now. And now the face.
Stop breakfast show on TV. Show on TV.
All right, you're welcome back. It's still your one-stop breakfast program on MCL TV. Good morning, Abia. It's good to welcome you to our discussion segment this morning. Before we went on that very break, I had told us that we're going to be centering on the fourth anniversary of the Chibok Girls. Well, we celebrate birthdays. We celebrate a whole lot of anniversaries. They call it your marriage anniversary, organization's anniversary, and all the rest of them. We have one anniversary or the other. But today, we're talking about the Chibok Girls, the fourth anniversary of the Chibok Girls. It's actually 4 years that these kids were adopted. We've played politics with the Chibok Girls adoption. I'm sure you know that Nigeria have tried to play politics with it. Anyhow you want to look at it, we've played politics with that. It was part of the campaign promises of the president that he was going to ensure that before few months that all the Chibok girls were brought home. The former president did say he did a whole lot to bring back the Chibok girls. We set out on security. But today, after 4 years, some of these girls are still in captivity. And so what would you say is of them so far? Even if they come back today, are they coming back as girls, or are they coming back as women? Well, the news today as well has it that about 17 parents of these Chibok girls are now dead. What is the cause of their death? These are things we're going to be taking a look at in today's discussion. And I have in the studio men that have always been here to talk about this and other issues, men that knows their onions, men that knows that the nation has to really be, you know, protected. And how do you protect it? By saying the right thing at the right time, of course, as it has to do with being plain. Talking about
Comrade Ike of Igwe, you're welcome to the program, sir.
Welcome. Good morning and good morning, viewers.
It's so good to have you, sir, and that you're vast. And when it comes to things like this, I know the way you feel about it, and we're excited you're here this morning to give us those decisive analysis of yours again, as it has to do with the whereabouts of the Chibogas. Okay, next to him is a man where you will call him the voice of the people at all times. He speaks up his mind. He doesn't really care who is involved. Talking about another person than Comrade Uche Emeku. You're welcome to the program, sir.
Yeah, thank you, moderator, and good morning, audience.
All right, another young man that, well, you will say is always there whenever you also need him. A legal practitioner, one that speaks up at all times, too. Barrister Collins O'Neill. You're welcome to the program, sir.
Yeah, thank you, moderator. Good morning, audience.
All right, gentlemen, the Chibok girls are 4 years in captivity. And we know very well that nobody is happy about it. And when you talk about the Chibok girls, it just started in a day and it was like a dream. And gradually, every day keeps playing out a new page. Every day we keep hearing new things. And more adoptions are still taking place. But we're centering on the Chibok girls. Opiwe, I want you to look at the Chibok girls, the way it started and how it has metamorphosed into an international issue. It metamorphosed into an international issue. The world came, said all sort of things. And today, we're still talking about some of them still being held in captivity.
Okay, no, it was on 14th April 2014 that the news just broke out that around 276 Chibok girls has not been abducted in their school, taking their WAEC exam. One, when the news broke out, as you said, it was just like a dream. How possible that you can take 276 school girls out? The security operatives, what are they doing? The military checkpoints there, why haven't they intervened any of them? The police checkpoints there, why haven't done anything? And to make it worse, the gathering of intelligence they are giving to the then President Jonathan was too poor. Because President Jonathan didn't believe in the first instance that the abduction took place. It was dramatized. Is it true? Is it not true? What is happening? And you should understand that at a certain time, the wife of the president also came out and said, we sure, remember there is God though, which means they didn't believe it. And the 276 children or students were taken out without the intervention of any security officer. It's amazing. Everybody shouted, their parents shouted, Nigerians shouted, international community shouted, bring back our girls shouted, prominent people shouted, bring back these girls, because it have never happened anywhere again. But you ask yourself, from Sambista Forest to that Chibok community is more than 500 kilometers, if you have done geography study well. You ask yourself, how can a government that have primary duty to secure life and property, and the students we are taking from a school, nobody questioned, nobody intercepted, nobody asked questions, no checkpoint were dedicated, and they were taken more than 5 kilometers away to Sambista Forest, and today is a story. That brings us to the value of our security agents. Did they believe in Nigeria? Did they believe in one Nigeria? Are they aiding these people? Is it a threat that have just come into existence where people have to do to make their millions of naira or dollars and just pocket it? Then is a real situation question. By now, no security agents have been fired. All the presidential reports and here and there, none of them have been released. The Inspector General of Police, then we are so secure, not fired. The military have not, I'm a chief of staff, and the first time by then have not given us reason what happened. So to us, as you said, it remains a drama till today, what is still happening about the Chibok girls.
You know, Emeku, look at what the picture he has just painted, but your own picture from time have always been. But you really recall that when this thing took place initially 4 years ago, in this program, some of us or some months, you people felt it was a drama, that it was not real. Gradually, it became, you know, real. Now, would you say that Nigeria, from inception, never handled this case the way they ought to? That 4 years after, we are still talking about this girl still missing.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Moderator. You see, I'm particularly emotional about this issue. At the outset, I didn't believe it was possible. At the outset, I believe it was all politics. I believed some people wanted to hoodwink us, all of us, into going to the lines they want to take. But today, 4 years down the line, precisely it was last Saturday, we are still talking about these things. It is not just 4 days, it is not just 4 weeks, not 4 months, but we are talking about 4 years. And that's about 416 weeks, if I'm correct. You know, taking 208 weeks. You are not sitting with your daughter. You do not hear her cries. You do not know her vision any longer. Meanwhile, by the time you gave birth to this child, you saw the future. You had a vision. You have a dream. And you decided that this child was going to be something of value, not only to yourself, but to your community and to Nigeria and the world as a whole. And you took her to school. In an environment she is to understand the ways of the world and maybe make a choice out of it. She has a dream of becoming maybe a doctor. She has a dream of becoming a leader. She believes she can contribute her quota, and you as a father, you as a mother, you as uncles, you gathered around and began to see a new Nigeria in this girl. And suddenly, the girl is no more, not because she died, but because somebody decided to change her course in life without her permission, without your own permission. And to make this matter worse, we have a government whose primary duty should be security. Because I don't think government exists for any other thing. It is we submit ourselves, we subject ourselves to the rulership of certain individuals who believes they know the way better than us. We pay our taxes to them. They recruit men to guide us. And at the end of the day, 4 years down the drain, you are not with your child.
Now, 4 years down the drain, Oni, I'll come back to you. Hold on, Emeka. 4 years after, we're still talking about these girls. And we have a government in place, like Emeka said. A government in place that should guarantee the safety of every Nigerian, every one Nigerian. And 4 years after, these girls are not, you know, nowhere to be found. Some of them. What does that?
One retired general, I think, from the U.S. did say something. He said, if there's an abduction, okay, and that the government could not recover the person who abducted within 24 hours, if the government is not aware of it, is responsible. See, the just like the first speaker said, that the whole thing looks like a drama. If you ask me, I'll tell you it's still a scam. If you remember, one of the your journalist brother Ahmed, he said something, I think Sakida or something, that out of the purported adopted girls, only 15 are still alive, and that those 15 have been married off long ago. So why do I say it's a scam? If it is actually, if, because this guy was one of the negotiators, if he's saying this thing It's anything to go by. Why would the federal government, after saying that Boko Haram had been defeated, now requesting for $1 billion to fight a group that have been technically defeated? You see, the federal government has acted in an unbelievable manner over the whole saga, so that it is difficult now to gain the confidence of the people. I can't tell you that I believe in the cause of fighting distance. It's no longer real. I mean, if that woman was saying for about 276 girls taken to where? Do you know what it is to keep those girls? Even upon those 82 that were released, if you look at them, no, let's be honest to ourselves. The journalists were not even allowed to interview those girls on that very day. And the journalists who are meant to be the middle of the society, you keep them away from interviewing those girls. If you remember, I keep saying, there was this man that said, it is better you give me a press than give a government without a press. I prefer to have a press rather than have a government without a press. Because the press there remains the mirror of the society. As soon as those 82 girls were negotiated and were returned, the next thing should have been, journalists should have been given access to interview these girls.
To find out what they went through.
Yes! But another thing is, upon their release, if you look at those girls, let's call it spanish, they look so healthy. I mean, somebody these were persons that were taken against their will for how many years, and upon their release they were looking so healthy. That's another issue here is the Sambisa forest. Is it not a place the army says they have combed? So where else were they taken to? Is the Sambisa forest unreachable? Can't it be combed? Is the area so large that you cannot cover it within a space of 1 month with all the military might? So you see, the federal government, like I keep saying, have acted in such a way that it is difficult at this point to gain public confidence. When the present administration came in, he said within the period he was sworn in May, he gave the military between that period till December, that there won't be anything like that again. So, you see, the circumstances is such that the federal government, I mean, has not acted in a manner to gain public confidence. And that is why people keep saying it's a scam.
And governance is all about confidence.
Okay, I'll give another instance. Setima, if you remember on the day the incident happened, the principal of that school was warned not to have that exam conducted there. And you know, it was a day they were to write physics. 276 students to write physics in a state that is educationally disadvantaged. You know what physics is. So how come they have that number? And also, the principal daughter was also in school but was not taken. Then after that incident, the mother, the principal was made a commissioner in Setima's administration. So there are a whole lot of complaints.
You see it as a setup.
Yeah, why would that girl, the principal daughter, not among the persons abducted? Why?
All right, now, looking at this situation, would you still hope that or believe that the Chibok girls, if it actually took place, are still alive?
Okay, from all indications and what we are seeing, the person who first said that the government didn't do what they're supposed to do and that there's no way all the girls can come back alive, that's number one. Number two, what worries me most, before I even dive into it, is that upon all the money we are voting for security, no other country in the world can have such experience and not finding solutions. Or the whole aircraft, modern ones, and all the rest of them, what are they doing? For example, let me tell you, in 1962, you know that Russia went to Florida, 90 kilometers to Florida, and just put a head of missiles, very tiny and small thing, and put it there. 90 Florida to Florida, because that is the military base of U.S. Then, U.S. have as well gone to Tunisia, where Russia have this thing for a long time, and put it. What I want to tell you is that when CIA and others couldn't even find what happened, the FB-2 plane that was flying just picked a snap of it, which nobody could have believed. Very tiny thing. And that is an instrument of complex warfare. And it was analyzed. Behold, it's a missile warhead. How can you keep 275 children, students, take it even 50 that you divided them and put them in separate bases. None of our security gazettes have made any attempt to get a snappy picture of what is really happening. And you are telling me that we still have a government we should have confidence in. How can all of them be alive? When Amila escaped from that captivity, which we have showed on television and all the rest of them, he told us then that six of them have died. That was 2 years ago. The journalist Ahmed Sabat, Ahmed Sadit, that he has been investigating the thing that is closer to them, like the one you called Mama Boko Haram. Even when the bad she gets, he said the children are in my custody. They will be released in 2 weeks time, and they will release in 2 weeks time. That is to tell you that people are in contact with them, like that Ahmed Sadiq. Then Ahmed Sadiq have done his own investigation. He's a journalist in the whole world, I believe, that has been working with the Boko Haram clan, reporting what is happening there. BBC have said it, CNN have said it, Al Jazeera have said it, and they have told you now that out of the 113 students we said that they are still in captive there, that is only 15 that is still alive. And there's 15 that are still alive that they have been married to some commanders. The fate of releasing them is no longer in the hand of Shekuru, who is the Boko Haram commandant when this thing was done, whom the government said they are negotiating with, that is in the hand of their husbands now to say whether they will release them or not release
is
them.
Is that not crime? Is that not crime? Like, with all the analysis that have been given on this issue have suggested that these children have been, the girls have been married off.
Yeah.
And apart from being married off, some of them have been killed. And government is still telling us on daily basis that they will still release the Chibok girls, that they're still struggling for them to be released. Why are we, playing politics with it? Is this not a criminality?
First of all, you ask me whether I believe that the Chibok girls, because from the analysis we are doing here, somehow, somewhere, there are contradictions. You don't believe, you go this way. You've not drawn your own line. Now, like this morning, the paper has reported that 17 parents of these girls are dead. And the people giving you this information is they bring back our girls group, which means this, because it's an independent body, it is not an organization sponsored by the government. So they are very much in contact with these girls. I want us to, first of all, believe, because it is not because your daughter is not involved, I mean your biological daughter, you believe that it is politics all along. There may be some element of politics there, but there are still girls, even if they are married off, they are still the girls, and we need to see them, and we need to come in contact. I believe that the government has not done enough as to provide information through intelligence. Because I remember that even when Obama won that election, and Osama bin Laden was not seen anywhere, he made it a priority that every 30 days that information, the progress report on Osama should be given to him until through a newspaper supplier, they established that Osama is somewhere and before they took him out. Now the question is our government really doing the needful as to pinpoint where these girls are? And I believe also that they may not be in Sambisa Forest. They may be somewhere in Niger Republic, because we have a very porous border between Nigeria and Niger Republic. And so I believe that, I said, 4 years, well, I'm no longer talking about whether it is a fact or not. Because look at the case of Leah Sharibu. Now, she's nowhere to be found. Nobody can pinpoint where she is. The other 105 has been returned. But this girl is out there. And again, on Saturday, I listened to the lecture. The names of these girls were mentioned, which means they were there. Their parents, I think their parents also attended some of this thing, this thing. But my own major problem about this thing is that if our president or if Nigeria
is interested in the girl child. That is the major thing. I am now shifting away from politics into the reality of the future of our girl child. Are we actually doing what you are supposed to do? Whether it is politics or not, at least, if not any other thing. That girl, Leah Sharipu, tells us that something is happening. Another thing that is happening is that some people are used as a pawn in the game. Those who escaped on that day, who are in the United States now, some of them given a scholarship by Atiku Abubakar in his school. I mean, they have told you, actually, yes, there are some girls. There could be a mix-up. It may not be up to that number, but is it a reality? I now agree that it is a reality. Because I've heard some people speak, those who should know, those who are in contact, those who have third eyes as to what is happening. So what I am saying is this. With the Chibok girls, 4 years down the line, we are not supposed to be playing politics any longer. We are not supposed to be speaking from both sides of the mouth. We should come down to tell our people the reality on the ground. And what do we do? Now, remember these girls you are talking about. That no counselor's child is there. No government official, child is there, no matter how highly placed. Just peasants. And why would a parent die for a child that, out of trauma, for a child that was never kidnapped in the first place? So what I am saying is that right now, we need to hold our government accountable. They have to tell us what is actually on the ground. Because this thing is assuming another dimension.
Okay, now
you release 112 and then take 112.
That is what I think, Emeku. A government that has stayed 4 years without returning people supposed to have been adopted 4 years after. A government as big as federal government could not, no intelligence gathering available, no moves have been made to liberate these girls. And also, Barrister, you're going to come in here, but I want to bring back to you what you said. You said the journalists, one of us, have also said that either some of these people have been married off or they are dead. If they know they've been married off, because when they went to take that very way, you have your passports. Everything about you is there. Your name is there. Where you're from is there. In other words, the identity of the people is not unknown.
Yes.
Their pictures is not unknown.
Yes.
Once you blow the picture, you can trace these kids wherever they are. So if they've been married off, and we know those they've been married off to, can they be traced, arrested, and then be made to be Boko Haram as well? Do you think there's a setup and cover up in all these things?
Let me tell you, one man made a write-up, and as the whole incident begins to unfold, I begin to believe what that man said. He said, and I liken it to a situation like this, there was a matter I did where two persons were working in a company and the other one happens to be the head. When the one that is the head traveled, there was some money that came in. The second took the money and absconded. So upon his coming back, he was arrested and brought to police. So when the matter went to court, the man raised an issue that this man can only be involved in this stealing if actually he told his second, say, take this money, go to a certain place, when I come back I'll meet you, we'll share the money, then you take off. Or he told him, take this money, go to a certain place, I'm going to meet you there. And upon going there, the guy now decided on his own to leave without, you know, them sharing that money, in whichever way he is involved. Okay, I say that to mean that, you see, the way the whole thing is turning out to be looks like this. That there was an arrangement, actually, to take some girls, okay, with the principal's consent, but not with the parent's consent. Even if it is with the parent's consent, they never had thought it was going to last as long as this situation. Because from the Dapchi girl, you know, if you borrow a leaf from what happened with the Dapchi girl, you know that it is still the same thing. You see, there was a deal. Let's stop this deal. Let's take these girls away to make this government unreasonable, to make this government unable to protect life and property. But we shall release this girl on hand within so so number of days. Okay, and in the course of doing that, you know, not all that you predicted now came to be. That is exactly what played out there.
what you think plays out, not what
plays out. Let me tell you something. No, I'm
entitled to his opinion.
I know.
Don't interrupt me.
You see, our problem, sir, is this. You see, if you look at the whole lot of unanswered questions concerning these Chibok girls. A whole lot of unanswered questions. See, there was actually adoption taken out of their way, okay? And then when you marry someone out of his way, that is even rape or defilement if they are underage. All these things happen. So I'm not saying that it never happened, but that wasn't the original plan from the way the whole thing is going. Because if you tell me that you take somebody and the person will last for 4 good years with all the military might, it's unbelievable. Okay, when the United States came in, why did they leave? They left because they noticed that the government was, even the military then, was not sincere in fighting this thing. There was a whole lot of insincerity, a whole lot of obscurity, on clear terms, on clear issues. So they now wanted to lose any of their soldiers because they know the worth of a military, a soldier in the U.S., what it takes to train a soldier. When the soldiers, in fact, at the point you heard it, that about 500 Nigerian soldiers escaped to Cameroon. Do you know that in a war time, 500 soldiers can take over a state?
Of course.
So, I mean, why would 500 soldiers escape to Cameroon? All that to make the government unable to fight that cause. You see, let us be realistic at the point. Do you know what 500 soldiers, if 500 soldiers enter into this banner, say they want to wipe out this, they wipe the whole banner. So 500 soldiers escaping to Cameroon, and Cameroon government that is lesser than Nigeria in terms of military might arrested the soldiers and brought them to Nigeria. Disarmed them and brought them to Nigeria. What was that supposed to mean?
All right. Thank you very much, viewers. We have to go for a break. Now, when we come back, the phone line is going to be opened and you'll be part of this very discussion. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Show on TV.
Show on TV.
Chukwu nenye kari onye obula. Chukwu nenye kari onye obula. On any kind of rubeke neri big, no one. On any you, on any you, on any you.
Hello, my name is Bucci. Keep watching MCL TV and don't go away.
Aye, God has given you victory. Aye, He has given you victory. Aye, God has given you victory. Aye. He has given you victory. What's up, people? It's your boy E-Ben ministering to God's children. And you're watching MCL TV. Don't touch that dial. Peace. I love you.
MCL, the word in your home.
One
non-stop breakfast show on TV. Show on TV.
Right, you're welcome back, and the phone line is now going to be opened, and you're going to have the opportunity of joining us in this very interesting topic, talking about the Chibok Girls, the fourth anniversary. Before we went on that very break, Barisone had tried to establish what looks like a scam that, you know, I had asked the question, are they still alive? Now, if a child is kidnapped or your child is kidnapped and you don't see that child after 4 years, what will be your fate? Will you continue to fight for the child to come back? But that's the situation we have right now. I'm coming back to you, Opigo.
There was a point I wanted to make last before.
Okay, you know? go ahead. You
know, Just by way of addressing what my colleague here is saying. You see, one man said, buying the Chibok girls' adoption story without asking questions is tantamount to helping the government get away with their satanic business of subjecting our national intelligence to ridicule. You see, the military acts on intelligence. So are those intelligence now being subjected to ridicule? So if you say you want to swallow everything hook, line, and sinker, it means there is no more intelligence. So if things are not going the way it should be, by all reasonable standard, you should be able to ask questions. That is why we have critics. Okay, if you say this thing is this way, why is this way? If you say those girls were actually adopted, why were they looking very healthy on the very day they were released? If you say there was actually an adoption, why didn't you allow the journalists to have access to the girls? At least to tell us the impression they have about the girls. These are questions. Do you know, releasing somebody after 4 years and not allowing the people to even have a face talk with them, is it proper? It raises a whole lot of questions. So, you can't be saying that, we should not allow emotions.
To be glad,
our sense of reasoning.
Okay, now when you look at it from this
way, let me
now, come. Would you? All right, let's begin to take the calls. Hello, good morning.
Hello, good morning, sir.
You're welcome to the program.
Yeah, thank you, and good morning, all the panelists.
Good morning.
The suggestion, the analysis by the lawyer, is the real truth of it. The whole thing of this Chibok girls was based on arrangement. But incidentally, what they have agreed initially is it did not work well. It fell behind the expectation. Because it then opposition government, things did not work that way. The arrangement is not the way they were expected. But the issue is that up till now, nobody knows the truth. The government will say that nothing. The people, this other side will say another thing. Like, it's a journalist that makes a declaration that 180 rules have died, and the government is coming back and say that man has not been, he has never defended them, he has not been a part of the negotiation. But that man is a well-known person. He finally said the truth. But the government that is working under propaganda and the deception keep deceiving the public. So I stood by the suggestion of that barrister that what he said is the real truth.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Though you didn't tell us your name and where you're calling us from, but it's good.
Oh, I am Alfred. I'm calling from here.
All right, you're welcome, Alfred. Thank you very much for calling. All right, Obigwe. If you look at all that has played out with the Chibok girls, as a government, if you're the government or the president, do you think we've acted in our best capacity, the highest capacity, talking about the lives of Nigerians? When Emeka was making analysis of the situation, Emeka said no child of any influential person, you know, is in that very group. Forgetting that those people will turn out tomorrow to be the influential of the society. Now, as a government, 4 years after, even after you played politics, we did campaigns here and there with it. We are told within how many months that the everything about it. Are we even supposed to play politics with things like this?
I mean, it's good to say this, that Chibok's abduction is conspiracy of the elite. It's real. Why is it real? We have military commands, police posts along that side. Amnesty International, moreover, have come out openly to say, we gave the military command notice, and they have more than 6 hours notice that something is going to happen that Chibok's, which is abduction. The military couldn't act. Amnesty International is not a small body that will tell you information.
Yes.
All over the country, all over the world, you will not take them very, very serious. When they release information in any country, the country takes it very serious. Then the simple question you ask yourself is this. Why is it that when Amnesty International released the information to the security operatives of the last government, that didn't take the information serious? That's why I say it's conspiracy. Let me tell you, at the dying days of Jonathan administration, when all these things happened, Jonathan was not in control of the security apparatus of the country again.
Yeah.
Because he relied on them, appointing them from one section of the country. When it happened, Jonathan was helpless. That was the much reason why, if you watch the campaign well, that they're not sold out Jonathan, and this is one of the conspiracies of the elites. Let me come in there. Compare it with even that abduction that happened yesterday. I saw when Femi Adesanya was talking from London last night at Channel Television, and he's comparing two of them. The same Amnesty International said, we gave them information, and none of them have denied this thing. Both the military command, both the police, both the DSS, both the director of military intelligence, and all the rest of them, none of them have come out to say, Amnesty International, you don't give us information. When this information we are giving to them, what did they do? Conspiracy of the elite again.
Yeah.
Let's compare it, that's what the government now is saying, with what happened to Jonathan. When we do it, we give a timeline and just bring them back.
Yeah.
When the conspiracy happened, as the lawyer have said, you know, they are having the mind that when this thing happens, if Jonathan goes out, we bring them back. That's why the present government said that after a few months of this thing, these girls will be back. You know, they were selling it authoritatively there.
Yes.
But what happened in that early conspiracy of the elites is that when they went back there, the people that are in control of these girls, they have changed their mind. They have seen many things.
Yes.
Maybe they like most of these girls, maybe one thing or another. And that's the much reason why the government moved out with the force of bombardment, this present government, to see what will happen. And in the process of that bombardment, many of those girls died. That brings me back, how do we value our citizens here? We're even going far. Let me tell you, if the government is saying
some of them are dead. If this person says some of them are dead, let's exchange, do exchange of even the Boko Haram we are holding with the dead ones to make pride of this nation if we value them. Let me tell you.
Now you try
in 1968, to... in 1968, let me tell you, Hamas did a raid on Israel, simple country that value their citizens. Israel, we are holding more than 100 Hamas in prison. And when the raid was done, one military, one armed officer of Israel was killed. And Hamas took hold of that dead body on their own side, Palestinian side. Netanyahu and all the rest of them, they are mad. They are saying no. It's even a disgrace, a national disgrace, that Hamas took our dead, not living, dead soldier. What do we do? They went into negotiation with Hamas and said, we will release to you 48 living souls of Palestinians and Hamas we are holding. Release to us only that one dead Israeli soldier.
That's true. That value.
Country that value the life of their people. Country that value their citizens. Country that value, that have pride, that whatever happened to one citizen have happened to the whole country.
That is
And what did they do? A one dead Israeli soldier was exchanged for 48 Hamas and Palestinians being held hostage.
All right.
Pride of a nation.
All right, pride of a nation. Let's take this call. We'll continue the discussion. Hello, good morning. Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to the program.
Good morning, my name is
Go ahead, we can hear you.
I think General Benjuma captured the truth of the whole matter. There appears to be a plot, you know, premeditated plot to disseminate some people in the Northwest. You know, whatever I call it, ethnic cleansing or people of some faith. And that there is a military conspiracy as well, that the army has been compromised. Coming from such a high-ranking military ex-military officer, Nigerians want to believe in what has played out. I mean, that is, people that have been under captivity, even when the president promised only 2 months to get them to leave. And 3 years after,
very much, and do have a lovely day. God bless you.
Should I
go ahead?
Okay. What I was saying is that if we value the life of our citizens, even one of them, why is it that even when this present government were doing the negotiation, they didn't negotiate for the whole years? It's a serious question. You should know. And mind you, the present government didn't negotiate directly. They were negotiating through Red Cross and Swiss government. Those were the two bodies that did it. Then, when they are negotiating it, and they said they have released 87, that it remains in the 113. Why is it that they didn't negotiate for 113 Chibok school girls that were remaining there? That is to tell you that you may not know everything about Chibok girls now. But in the future, yes, you will know the real drama and the conspiracy of the aliens that played out.
Right.
Let me tell you and let you know. Go and mark my word somewhere. After many years now, CIA, FBI will tell us really what happened. Go and mark it somewhere. Because the international community have sold that conspiracy. That's why they are kept quiet over the whole thing. If not, I challenge even the present government today. Military formation is a complex thing. Tell us why the Amnesty International information that this thing will happen in the next 6 hours, you did not take it serious. Tell us why. Can't you hire a plane in America here? Do spy. You see these bugs where they are. That's the truth of the matter. Just hire military spy plane. I told you what happened in 1962. Yeah. When even a head, not a human being, when you talk of head of a missile, it's so tiny and so small. But the SW2PI plane that was flying, just picked it. If you can pick the warhead of a missile that is so tiny and so small, chibogues are easy to pick, but the world community, international community have come in and saw the high level of elite conspiracy that happened. They kept quiet.
All right, now let me ask you this. Compare chibogues and the Dapchi girls. Now, if you look at the response and the way they were brought back, even though it's still a drama, I call it drama, because you don't tell me that the government will be in place, security in place, everything in place, and you adopted girls and brought them back in the full glare of the people, and you celebrated them and left. Why? What sort of negotiation was entered into that the Dapchi girls were released within some hours that they've not been able to achieve with the Chibok girls?
Remember that the Chibok issue is under a different regime.
Mm.
And also,
he said under a different regime.
And yes, it wasn't Muhammadu Buhari's regime. It's not the government of APC.
But government continues.
I am coming. I know the difference between government and politician. I know the difference.
Hmm.
The government official comes from the politician. But what I'm saying is, it's under different regime. And these two regimes have their own policies and ideologies, and they have the way they handle matters from their discipline. But what I'm saying here is that first, we have established that there was kidnapping, whether by conspiracy or whether not conspiracy, but there was kidnapping. Whatever is playing out presently is what I don't like. That is the politics about it. Now, in the case of the other one, it was also near the election period. And Jonathan, being from a certain minority of Nigeria, was not so much trusted even by the Northerners and the Southerners. And they were looking for a way, one thing to do to get the distance. And I remember it was this man, this other man that came for PDP chairmanship, Sherif, Ahmadu Sherif. Remember it was he himself, under his own watch, that this issue of Boko Haram now took a very fearful dimension because of his relationship with Yusuf, the first leader of Boko Haram. And then remember that when Jonathan tried to get to the north with the soldiers, the northern elder started crying that Jonathan was about killing all of them. And in fact, they made attempts to, you know, to write to ICC. I don't know whether they finally did or they stopped halfway. Now, in the case of this present government, now the Dapchi issue was from also another party and another Nigerian, from what you might try to look at as an oligarchic north that tried to do this one. And then within 1 month, these girls, under the same style that they were taking, were also released back, with only one girl remaining, which now gives it a religious coloration. But what I am saying here is not who did what or what happened anywhere. What I'm saying is that how do we value our girl child? How? Because the main people you are talking about now is the girls. What is the future of the Nigerian girls? Whether it is this government or the other government,
Jonathan did cry out. He said that he has saboteurs in the military. He said it. I don't know whether we still remember that. And nobody, you know, came forcefully to look at this thing. And because his government was to be brought down. But what I am saying is this. Now that we have a government in place, I am no longer talking about Jonathan. He has done his bit. He is gone. He is left for posterity to judge him. And I'm very happy that posterity or history does not have mercy when it comes to judgment. It gives you your portion and you must accept it because you will not even be there again to say anything. Now, what I am saying is this. It is no longer whether these girls were used for politics or not. That is not my interest. My interest is that what is the welfare of the girl child? Yesterday, I did go to a particular federal government school and I took a look around. I walked around. I saw a lot of this. I began to imagine how it was possible to do this thing and at what purpose. And has the purpose been achieved? If it has been achieved, okay. If it has not been achieved, why don't you come back, bring these girls intact? I am not interested in who took anything away. I am not interested in the conspiracy that is there because that is not what will bring these girls back right now. What we are saying, what particularly I'm saying, is that let government of the day, however they will do it, let them do it so that these little girls will go back to their parents. Why I did, government exposed a politically exposed person or businessman of high caliber is there. It's not that I am looking at the girls as non-entities. They will grow up tomorrow, but I'm looking at them as pawn that is being used by the bourgeois, I mean, to play down on us.
All right,
and
now,
so the issue is this. What I am saying, what is this present government doing? The politics is okay.
All right, now
we have enough.
All right.
How do we take our girl child?
Now, talk about the politics. That is, it has played out in so many ways. We all see it. We discuss it, like it or not.
Yeah.
You have a mind of your own.
Yeah.
And as much as I will agree that you can't come out and begin to cry on the street, this is a platform you're establishing, you're showcasing whatever it is that you feel
you
about the situation. Now, Oni,
so,
do you think this is also a cheap political point somebody's trying to score? Whoever it is that arranged, because you people have been able to establish that is an arrangement, conspiracy, use any nomenclature. Whosoever arranged that one, I've also arranged this other one, to still discredit the government of Jonathan, to also man like, that thing happened that we return them in few hours. Chibok happened, Jonathan couldn't return them in few hours. Does it move in this direction? Are we looking at that as just a coincidence? A couple of girls were kidnapped again and then they were brought back. Chibok have not been brought back. 4 years after, we're still talking about them. But that thing that just happened and few hours or some hours later or few days, you brought them back. What is the position of this very military or whichever intelligence they used in bringing back Dapchi girls, that they could not, they've not been able to achieve in bringing back Chibok girls 4 years after? What played out here that couldn't play out during the Chibok girls?
You see, upon the abduction of the Dapchi girl, Buhari visited the home or something. And the only thing he kept on saying was that those girls, Dapchi girl will come back in no time. And upon their return, you heard what he said, that his own didn't happen like that of Jonathan. It took him 18 days to, you know, come up and all that. That those guests are by. Kept on blaming the past administration for its inability to bring back the Chibok girls. That was just what he ended up saying. In fact, he never said much about the Dapchi girl. But see, events kept on unfolding. That those bandits brought those girls in a broad daylight. Okay, let me give you an instance. If in a normal setting, someone is kidnapped in Abia State by kidnappers, and the police negotiated on how the person would be brought. So if the kidnapper eventually brings the person, they will let the kidnappers go scot-free. So is it now that crime has been legalized? No, that's what it shows. Because if they were even celebrating with soldiers, and it was even on record that at that point that the state was heavily guarded by soldiers. They came with about 2 or 3 killers, brought those girls, and they still let them go. So some persons now have the right to commit crime
and go scot-free. That's what it means. If a kidnapper in Abia, say, I'll give you an answer, kidnap somebody, would they let him go? The consequence is there. So why would some persons be treated as a sacred cow? So the event that keeps on unfolding gives it the true picture of what it is. And you also know that there was this story that they were paying some money to do that. That was on internet. Okay? But whether or not that story is true, the way the whole thing played out, gives credence to that the federal government actually may have orchestrated what happened. Because, I mean, you cannot tell me, it's not practicable. A kidnapper is a kidnapper any day, any time. And if you look at even what played out in this release of 82 girls, before the release of those 82 girls, 9 soldiers were killed 24 hours after that they released 82 girls. Is that how to negotiate? And if you are negotiating, it means you've been talking before that day. So how could it be that 24 hours after you kill our Nigerian soldiers, you release 82 girls?
And you are still allowed to
kill. And you are still allowed to. So this thing is not here nor there. I am not confused about the whole thing. The only thing I know is that the federal government, in fact, okay, let me also give you an instance. That when Shekau came on board, he told Buhari that you have violated the agreement. You have to give us a state so that we can release the girls. That was the agreement. You give us a state. So, you see, all those things keep telling us something.
Gentlemen, on a final note, just 1 minute each. Opigwe, sorry. Where are we in this country? And do we still have hope of bringing these girls back? Are they past? Like the president said, he has brought back the Dapchi girls. Jonathan couldn't bring back the Chibok girls. But he said that he will bring back the Chibok girls within...
From that May to as December.
As you said, when Buhari have a talk with the Archbishop of England, Justin Webber, you know, if you look at that transcript, Archbishop of England showed concern over the Chibok girls once more. Even though I visited Nigeria during that period to see my empathy. And what the president could tell him is that they are not doing it in a noisy way, that they are doing it silently on what happened. As I said here, Chibok girls release is a foregone alternative. You can't bring all of them life again. It's not possible. But how is the government doing with the family that are bearing the burden and the pains of taking their kids, which the government is supposed to protect, which is the failure of government, is not the failure of the parents? That's one aspect of it. Number two aspect of it is that why is the government comparing this Dapchi drama with the Chibok girls? That is to tell you the conspiracy of the elite once more. But as I said before, while we are there celebrating, if you look at the video when they brought the Dapchi girls back, even the Dapchi village, they were shaking the so-called Boko Haram people, touching them, celebrating them as heroes. And Lai Mohammed told us there was a pause, a small pause of cease of operations before that was done. And they didn't mask their face. Everybody saw them. They have been celebrated. The elite conspiracy. And most important, before I conclude, why is it that even the present government didn't fire anybody in the military, in the police, in the security operatives, having notified them that such thing was happening, and they allowed it to happen, and no report today. If you are talking of Chabuzi girls, just take it as a foregone alternative. The election period is at hand. Jonathan was removed based, he lost a lot of votes based on those Chibok girls, not bringing them back. This government should also bear in mind that they will also answer a question at the polling booths. Why have you not?
All right, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Because of time. Emeku, just your last word. Thank you.
My last word is that no matter what happens, I want these girls released. I want their families adequately compensated. Right. Enough of this bullshit.
All right. Thank you very much, Anunil.
I pray that the federal government try to be very honest with this fight, okay, so as to gain public confidence. When Lai Mohammed said that when he was asked why would you be requesting for $1 billion to fight the technically defeated Boko Haram, he only said something that he was forced to say that Boko Haram had been technically defeated. It doesn't show honesty on the part of the government.
All right. Thank you very much. And thank you, our viewers, for also being part of this very discussion. I hope you've heard it all, as it has to do with the fourth anniversary of the Chibok girls, as we continue to pray that they will be brought back, even if it's just 10 of them that is left alive. Let them be brought back, and perhaps to those buried, exhumed, so that the confidence of Nigerians can be restored. We see you again tomorrow with another interesting topic. For now, sports is next. Please stay with us. Bye-bye. Hello.
Good morning and welcome to the sports segment of our program. My name is Jonah Oje. We will now be talking about so many activities in the world of sports, and especially the Commonwealth Games that just ended yesterday. Here in Nigeria tried her best to make sure that she claims some medals that will help in making the country proud. All right, let us now start from that, where Nigeria ended its competition at the Gold Coast 2018 Commonwealth Games with Aruna Kadri's table tennis silver medal, bringing the country's total haul at the event to 24. Kadri, who was beaten in the quarterfinal edition of the competition in Glasgow, Scotland lost the gold medal to Singapore's Gao Ning just before the closing ceremony yesterday. The 24 medals, which placed Nigeria ninth on the medals table, made up of nine gold, nine silver, and 6 bronze medals, a collection which Sports Minister Solomon Dalong believes is better than the Scotland 2014 total when compared on the basis of number of athletes featured in both competitions. Speaking to the contingent yesterday, Dalong said, "We have done the comparative analysis and looked at the size of our contingent when we went to Glasgow. It's a good thing there. In Gold Coast, all the gold medalists received $5,000 each. Silver got $3,000. Bronze, for those who won bronze medalists, they received their $2,000 each, while the relay teams got $9,000 each and $7,000 for those who won bronze medals. We say it's a good thing there that we did not hear our athletes saying that they were owed their camp allowances, their bonuses that they were supposed to be paid. We have seen a repentant minister of sports this time, making sure that the athletes who represented Nigeria at the 2018 Commonwealth Games received their bonuses, and I think that really contributed to them making the country proud. All right, we want them to continue like country like that in subsequent competitions. All right, let us now go over to the round leather game now. But first of all, I want to start with the Nigeria Professional Football League matches that really took place the weekend, where Abia Warriors at home drew 1-1 with Katsina United. Ekanemi recorded a 3-0 victory over struggling Hatla Football Club of Owerri. Another struggling team, Rangers, there in Enugu, played out a barren draw with Kwara United. Goran FC of Omoko settled for a 1-1 draw with Niger Tornadoes. Rivers United in Port Harcourt grabbed the 3 maximum point, defeating Nasarawa United 1-0, while Sunshine Stars defeated Wiki Tuaris 2-1. This is how it happened in the Nigeria Professional Football League matches. And for those who were able to grab the 3 maximum point, well, congratulations to you. For those who could not make it, well, you have other subsequent matches for you to grab your own 3 maximum points and make sure that you keep your hopes of winning the title alive. All right, away from that, now we travel to England, where it also happened at the weekend, where we saw different clubs engaging each other at different stadia to make sure that they claimed their 3 maximum points. And the league somehow ended yesterday, because Manchester City, they were declared the champions of the English Premier League after Manchester United lost at home 0-1 to West Brom. But in the result, Southampton at home lost 2-3 to Chelsea. Burnley defeated Leicester City by 2-1. Crystal Palace beat Brighton 3-2. Huddersfield were 1 goal better than Watford. At the Liberty Stadium, it was 1-1, Everton 1. Liverpool continued their winning streak with a 3-0 victory over Bournemouth. It was a bad day for Tottenham Hotspur as they lost 1-3 to Manchester City, and that meant that Manchester City has won the league, like we told you earlier. Newcastle United surprised Arsenal by beating them 2-1, while Manchester United lost at Old Trafford 0-1 to West Brom. And at the end of that match, Jose Mourinho was not a happy man. He was not a happy coach. He criticized and blamed the players for that loss to West Brom yesterday. To Manchester City and to Pep Guardiola, we say congratulations to you for becoming the champions of the English Premier League. All right, we'll come your way by tomorrow to bring you up to speed everything that is rocking the world of sports. My name is Jonah Ojo once more. I want to hand you over to Ojoba.
All right, thank you very much, Jonah, for that sports update, and a million thanks to you, our viewers out there. Thank you for being part of the Monday edition. We promise you tomorrow will be better. We'll come your way again, same time, same station. Onasala Chumwabia, we'll come up after now. Bye-bye.
MCL, the word in your home.